All right, folks, today we've got another tier list and we're going to be evaluating all 150 jokers in Balatro. Before we begin, I want to set a little bit of context here in that this is based on strategies involving completing gold stake runs, not getting giga high scores on lower stakes, but simply finishing ante 8 on the hardest difficulty. As far as my expertise, I have completed gold stake on all 15 decks and have done so numerous times on several of the decks. Now, for me, the most effective strategy in doing this is building around easily attainable and repeatable hands. Things often like high card and pair, while not as flashy, can keep you on pace with the high scaling stakes at harder difficulties. So there may be a little bit of bias towards that with that in mind, but these are the jokers that I find most effective for completing gold stake runs. A first is 8-ball, which creates a planet card when the played hand holds at least 2 8s. For me, this is an immediate D tier. With higher stakes runs, it's often rare that you can hold utility jokers like this that don't generate immediate point scoring value or econ, and random planets generally aren't going to scale very well, nor are they going to hit hands that you're often playing towards. Abstract Joker gives you plus 3 molt for each joker card, and I think this is something that's good early to help you get through those early rounds with a lot of money, but also plays well into the late game where you have a full Joker roster and it's giving you plus 15 molt, which is pretty respectable. And for that reason, I think it clearly belongs in A tier. Next up is Acrobat, which gives you times 3 molt on the final hand of a round. Multiplicative scaling is something that is absolutely critical for keeping up with the increased blind scaling, so this is something that I'm happy to see. It does have some downsides, especially if you're blowing through the rounds quickly with one or two hands. You might not get value off of it and you're carrying it. It's great against the needle, almost solos it on its own, and can save you if you're working on scaling up and aren't quite end game or late game strong yet. It can help you get through those early rounds and get you to the late game. Ancient Joker gives you times 1.5 molt for each card played of a specific suit. And the suit changes at the end of each round, so it can cycle between all of the suits. Because of the inconsistency, while it is a very good card and does give you some of that multiplicative scaling, I think that because you can't necessarily rely on it to hit the suit that you have or need each hand, it's probably a B tier for me, but does have some definite upside in the right deck or in the right build. Arrowhead gives played cards with spade suit plus 50 chips when scored. Now, this is similar to Ancient Joker, but because of the consistency of the fact that it's always spades and the fact that there aren't often a lot of great chip generators, especially early, I think this one is a little bit higher rated for me and belongs in A tier. Astronomer makes all planet and celestial packs in the shop free. And now, while this is great value once you get beyond orange stakes and the packs get really expensive, again, it's really hard to justify a utility joker like this, even though it is a lot of econ and a lot of money that it's saving you. There's no guarantee that the packs are going to give you something that you need, and planet card scaling starts to fall off late and definitely has some diminishing returns. Banner gives you plus 40 chips for every remaining discard. Now, oftentimes you are hurting for chips, and Banner can be a decent solution for that, but because of the reduced number of discards that you have on higher stakes, the value that you're getting off of this is a little bit lower. So at best, you're getting 80 chips and losing the ability to discard. So in certain decks, it can be very useful. It can be very good early for getting you through rounds. But for all those reasons, it falls off in the late game and probably belongs in C tier as a result. Baron is a rare joker that gives each king held in hand times 1.5 molt. This is something that is great for those giga high score runs that I was talking about earlier. You hold a bunch of kings in hand, ideally steal kings, and your number goes burr. But because of the reduced hand size in gold stake runs, that's a little bit less reliable. So it probably drops it down a tier. Still very good for getting repetitive multiplicative molt scaling, but not nearly as strong as it is when you have a massive hand at the lower stakes. Baseball card gives uncommon jokers each provide 1.5 times molt. Now, depending on your build, this could be great. If you get it early, you know to pick up uncommon jokers, even if there's some that you're maybe on the fence about in normal circumstances. Or if you already have a lot of uncommon jokers, you're just ecstatic to pick this up because it gives you so much potential times molt. But it's not an auto include in every situation, so it probably joins Baron in A tier. Blackboard gives times 3 molt if all cards held in hand are spades or clubs. This is one that I rate really highly, especially when I'm playing those easily attainable hands like pair and high card. it's not difficult to play a hand such that all of my red cards go out and all of my black cards stay in hand. So for that reason, times three molt is a lot of molt, and I give this an A tier rating as well. Bloodstone has a 1 in 3 chance for played cards with Heart Suit to give times 2 molt when scored. Now, because of the unreliability in this one, again, I'm going to rate it a little bit lower. You really want consistent point scoring when you're going at higher stakes because you have few hands, few options, and high chip values to attain. So because of the unreliable nature of Bloodstone, I put this in C tier. Obviously, if you're playing checkered deck, this might bump up a little bit because so many of your cards are hearts, but that's not always the case. Blue Joker gives plus 2 chips for each remaining card in your deck. This is, I've found, to be one of the most reliable early game chip generators, just to help you get through rounds and get your econ rolling over from the extra hands that you have available. Eventually, you do want to move out of it because it starts to fall off, but because of its ability to get through the early game, I put this one in B tier. Blueprint copies the ability of the Joker to the right. This is an immediate S tier for me. Essentially, this just copies your best Joker and gives you two copies of your best Joker. Having two copies of your best Joker is going to put you in a very, very strong situation. This is an auto-include if you have the money to buy it. It's there. You probably just buy it, no questions asked. Bootstraps gives you plus 2 molt for every $5 you have. Unfortunately, in higher stake runs, you need to be spending money or you're not going to be able to keep up with the increased blind scaling. So because of this, Bootstraps, while it does have the capacity to pop off if you're playing the Anaglyph deck and you get a double tag into a bunch of money, in a normal run, that's not going to be the case, and you're going to want to be spending probably down to the interest cap, if not below it in certain instances, just so that you can keep up with the pace of the gold stakes. So because of that, it falls into C tier for me. Brainstorm copies the ability of the leftmost Joker. Now this looks and sounds very similar to Blueprint because it is. It's just a second copy of your best Joker. It's probably a little bit worse in some instances because oftentimes your best Joker is a multiplicative scaling Joker that needs to go on the right side of your Joker list, and there's a little bit of tension there with Brainstorm wanting it on the left side, but you're still very happy to grab this. If nothing else, this just gives you a second copy of your best flat point scoring Joker, which you're definitely just happy to have. Bowl gives you plus 2 chips for each dollar you have. Now, like Bootstraps, this is going to be rated a little bit lower for me just because of, again, keeping up with the pace of gold stake is expensive to do. However, chips are a little bit more valuable just because there are fewer options often available to you, or at least fewer good options, so it's probably rated a little bit higher than Bootstraps for me, but probably in the same tier. Next up is Burglar. When a blind is selected, gain plus 3 hands and lose all discards. Personally, I'm a huge fan of this because the plus 3 hands not only gives you more time to scale certain jokers, but also gives you an econ bonus because extra hands remaining at the end of a blind is more money for you. So in addition to being a way to scale up your jokers, it can also be an econ joker. There's certain builds that definitely don't want this, and it can have a tendency to fall off late once you need to get into more multiplicative point scoring options. So for those reasons, it's B tier, really solid in the right context, but probably needs to get out of your Joker list at some point. Burnt Joker upgrades the level of the first discarded poker hand each round. Unfortunately, when you are playing higher stakes runs, you do lose some discards. So you, by default, have 2 discards. That means you're dedicating half of your discards to getting Burnt Joker value for something that, again, has diminishing returns. Now, that said, if you do get it early, it can help shape your run and push you towards those easily attainable hands, but it's probably going to be a card that gets out of your Joker roster a lot earlier than something even like a Burglar or a Blue Joker, just because once you've hit it a few times, that's probably a solid foundation and you need to get out and work towards something that's scoring you more immediate points. All that said, still a pretty good early pickup, and I put this in B tier if I can find it early. Business Card gives played face cards a 1 in 2 chance to give $2 when scored. Econ Jokers are important and helpful early, but do need to rotate out once you hit the interest cap or are approaching the interest cap and need to start focusing on points. However, it can give you some decent money, especially since face cards tend to want to be played, especially early to get you through rounds, so you can get some decent money off of this, but expect to move this out as soon as you get better point scoring options and you have your econ settled a little bit. That said, good early pickup for B tier. Kanyo is our first legendary Joker, which gains times 1 molt when a face card is destroyed. We talked earlier about how important it is to find multiplicative mult scaling, and while this isn't a reliable way to get there, it does increase faster than nearly any other multiplicative scaling option. And if you can find it, if you can hit the hang demand as well as other destroy effects, it can be the turbo nuts and carry you through the run. So for that reason, it's A tier. If you find it later, it might not have the capacity to pop off quite as much, or you may not find the pieces that make it pop off as much, but you're probably pretty happy to find it if you do. Similarly, Campfire gains times 0.5 molt for each card sold, but it does reset when the boss blind is defeated. This is a great, great pickup for nearly any deck late, because it allows you to leverage your early strength, which you turned into Econ, into massive, massive amounts of multiplicative scaling. And if your goal is just to complete the run, your last few shops can just be a spending spree where you buy, sell, and you can get this to a nutty, nutty multiplier that then allows you to just cruise through the final boss. Because of that, this is definitely an A tier for me. It's something that I underrated early on, but once I started picking it up, I just realized how crazy this card can get. Card Sharp is another joker that I underestimated in lower stakes runs. It gives you times 3 molt if played poker hand has already been played this round. Obviously, it has downsides against certain bosses or if you're not playing towards those easily attainable hands, but because those are the most effective strategy I've found for beating gold stake runs, I'm always happy to pick this up. I'm often naturally playing repeat hands over the course of a round anyway. This gives you a little bit of time to scale up some of your other flat molt jokers if need be, while giving you a reliable multiplier through the course of the run. For that reason, A tier. Cardomancer gives you a tarot card when the blind is selected. Tarot cards are often extremely powerful. Obviously, you can't always get the one that you want, but most of them do something very good for you that gives you immediate point scoring options or allows you to shape your deck in a way that makes it better for the future. For that reason, getting tarot cards at the beginning of each round is a B tier joker for me. It falls off late. You want to get value out of it early and then move out of it like some of the other B tier jokers. Castle gives +3 chips per discarded card from a random suit, and the suit changes every round. Now again, in gold stake runs, you have two things working against Castle here. You have a smaller hand size, so you don't always hit the cards that you're looking for off of the discard, and you have fewer discards. So this is a little bit lower value, but still very good as a chip engine if you can get it early and start ramping it up. So once again, this is a B tier option. Unlike the other B tier options, you want to get this early and keep it in your deck, but it's probably not a pickup that you want down the line when you're getting to the later antes. Cavendish gives x3 molt, but a 1 in 1,000 chance that this card is destroyed at the end of round. But the real downside here is that you do have to pick up the early Gross Michael in order to have this even available to you. So you need to carry a +15 molt, which is good, with the downside that it could disappear at some point, so you can't necessarily rely on it. So there is an actual downside other than the possibility that it gets destroyed, but if it does get destroyed and you do have this option, you just immediately add it to whatever run you're building towards because it takes your points to the moon. This is an easy S tier, even with a bit of effort required to get it even available to you. Ceremonial Dagger destroys the Joker to the right and permanently adds double its sell value to the molt. Unfortunately, while this does give you flat molt scaling, it also requires that you play down a Joker every round, essentially. So because of that, that's just not something that you can reliably do and simultaneously keep pace with the increased blind scaling. And this is one that I just skip in nearly every circumstance. Certificate adds a random playing card with a random seal to your hand at the beginning of the round. Random seal cards, not always going to be the best quality cards, but the seals themselves can provide you a lot of long-term value. So if you have an open Joker slot and you need to either get money, tarot cards, or even point scoring off the red seals going, this could be a good option for that. That said, it's something that I do often want to move out of once I'm trying to fill out my Joker roster and start scoring points. So similar to other ones, this belongs in B tier for me. Chaos the Clown gives you 1 free reroll per shop. This is another Joker that I underestimated very much early, but then I started using it and I realized just how much money this was providing me. I think of this as an Econ Joker that gives me +$5 every round, essentially, and allows me to see more Jokers in the shop to shape my build. If I already have a good roster of Jokers, I'm not going to rotate this in. I'm not going to sell anything for this often, but I will pick it up early just so that I can see more Jokers and start filling out that roster better. So for that reason, once again, B tier. Chakotay is another legendary Joker which disables the effect of every boss blind. Unfortunately, you really need a good roster of Jokers in order to support a utility piece like this, which isn't always the case. A lot of times you really need all five of your Jokers to be scoring points for you, but it can save you in a pinch and can make it easier to progress through the early rounds so that you don't have to worry about playing around the boss blinds. So situationally, it's very good, but in a lot of cases, it might not do as much as just a good point scoring Joker. So for that reason, it's a C tier Joker for me. Clever Joker gives plus 100 chips if played hand contains a four of a kind. Deck refinement can be really difficult on gold stake runs. You don't often have the time to do so. Obviously, the payoff when you do is huge and you can start making hands like four of a kind. But as a chip generating Joker, this is one that I'm often skipping, even if I am working towards that goal, just because I'm getting a lot of chips naturally from leveling up four of a kind or just playing four of a kind, and it's unreliable in its ability to proc its effect. Cloud 9 gives you $1 for each 9 in your complete deck at the end of round. If you compare this to something like Gold Joker, it's pretty much the same thing. It's a decent econ Joker, especially if you can get it early. Basically gives you $4 at the end of round, possibly giving you more, mimicking a full interest end of round bonus, and potentially doubling your interest if you're already interest capped. So it's a really solid econ Joker, again, something you want to move out of later, but really something that I'm excited to pick up if I have a point scoring Joker early or confident that I can get through the rounds. For that reason, it goes into A tier for me. Constellation gives you times 0.1 mult per planet card used. This is one that I rate very highly on lower stakes runs, but once you get past orange stakes, it gets really, really expensive to get online and to get value off of, and with a very marginal increase in molt scaling. Essentially, by the end of the run, you're paying $11 for 0.1 times molt, and that's just not fast enough to keep up with the blind scaling. There are some use cases if you have an abundance of money and are rolling over interest each time, or you are seeing an abundance of planet cards in the shop, you might be able to make use of this if you're in a pinch and need some multiplicative scaling. Most cases though, not a big fan of this on higher stake runs, C tier. Crafty Joker gives you plus 80 chips if played hand contains a flush. Now flushes are very strong early, but do fall off. Plus 80 chips is an okay amount if you're thinking about the early game, but you would rather have something that scales a little bit later going into the late game, and 80 chips simply doesn't match some of the other options. So I'll maybe pick it up early if I'm in a pinch and need a point scoring Joker. Other situations, I'm absolutely skipping this one, so C tier for me again. Crazy Joker gives you plus 12 molt if played hand contains a straight. Unfortunately, in gold stake runs, straights are really difficult to achieve because you have minus one hand size. Even if you have a utility Joker, that means you're not scoring very many points, and plus 12 molt is not going to solve your point scoring option and allow you to carry that utility Joker. So this is a D tier Joker for me. I skip it in almost every situation. Credit card allows you to go negative $20 into debt. I think credit card is something that's often slept on. There are two reasons to like credit card. First of all, it allows you to guarantee that you keep pace with the early game scaling in gold stake runs. Second of all, you don't have to use it just because you buy it. It costs a dollar, it sells for a dollar. You can just put it in your roster, and that way if an expensive Joker ends up in the shop that you can't afford, you can pick it up and figure it out later, and it can save the run and allow you to build around that Joker while getting strong enough to get out of debt for the late game. So because of that, I think that credit card just is a very useful piece. If you have an open Joker slot, you just pick it up, sell it if you don't need it, take advantage of it if you do. This is another strong econ Joker in an A tier for me. Delayed gratification gives you $2 per discard if no discards are used at the end of round. This can be decent econ depending on the build that you're playing towards, but it's highly situational and can make you weaker and actually lose money as a result of having fewer hands available. So it may not even get great value if you, at the cost of giving up on being able to discard. So highly situational, once again, a C tier Joker for me. It is something that I might pick up depending on the deck that I'm building. If I'm desperate for econ and I have space for it, could be interesting if I'm strong enough to play bad hands and get through rounds. Most other situations though, I'm passing over this one. Devious Joker gives you plus 100 chips if played hand contains a straight. Just like his friend Crafty Joker. Not a great pickup. Straights are very difficult to make, and 100 chips is not a great payout for having to deal with a difficult hand to make. Diet Cola allows you to sell this card to create a free double tag. Once again, this is a situational utility piece. It doesn't necessarily take up a Joker slot because it's temporary. You can sell it immediately and save the double tag until your next skip. So it can be good without costing you a lot of point scoring. That said, if you already have your Joker roster filled out, you probably can't pick this up unless you're looking to find something else as well. And there's no guarantee that you'll find a tag worth doubling up just because you pick up and sell out of the Diet Cola. So for me, it's a C-tier Joker. DNA reads, if the first hand of a round has only one card, add a permanent copy of it to the deck and draw it to hand. Essentially what you're doing here is you're trading a played hand for an extra copy of a card in your deck, which is extremely useful in a lot of cases, and especially useful if you get it early enough to where you can shape your deck around building towards specific hands like four or five of a kind. This is a great engine for getting that type of deck online if you can find it early, but does fall off towards the late game when you really want to leverage those big hands with big point scoring options. Still, if I find this early enough, this is an easy A-tier Joker for me and can carry the run into the late game. Driver's License gives you x3 Molt if you have at least 16 enhanced cards in your deck. x3 Molt is great. 16 enhanced cards is difficult to achieve for certain decks, so it doesn't fit into any build. You cannot afford to carry this Joker and work towards getting those enhanced cards in a gold stake run that costs you $8 immediately plus the interest on that and requires you to take a Joker slot that isn't scoring you points. However, if you do get it online, it's at the absolute nuts. x3 Molt is a lot of Molt. So for me, this is B tier. It's very good if it's active, but it's very difficult to make active. Droll Joker gives you +10 Molt if played hand contains a flush. I talk about this a lot, but I'm not a big fan of flushes on gold stake runs either because of that decreased hand size and reduced discards. But even if you are playing flushes, Droll Joker is just not a good Joker unless it's very early in the run because +10 Molt is not a lot of Molt. You compare that to something like Abstract Joker and it's just a worse option if you have a full Joker roster. So because of that, it's a D tier option. I'll pick it up if I'm desperate for point scoring in the early game, but move out of it as quickly as possible. Drunkard gives you a +1 discard. This is once again, one that I'm not a big fan of. I like those easily achievable hands, and this doesn't really do a whole lot for me in most cases. It might give my banner some extra points. It might allow me to make more difficult to attain hands, but I'm usually not a big fan of using Joker slots on high stake runs for utility, and that's what this does. So I might use this as a temporary measure if I generate it or don't have better options, but I look to get out of it pretty much as soon as I'm able to. So for that reason, C tier. Dusk retriggers all played cards in the final hand of a round. Now, like Acrobats, this gives you a big strength spike on your last played hand and can benefit from bonus cards or things that get benefits from cards being played. That said, I think it does a slightly worse job at getting you through the round than something like an Acrobat does. So it's a little bit lower for me into B tier, but still a pretty solid pickup in the right circumstances. It can be absolutely nutty. Egg gains $3 of sell value at the end of round. This is something that if I have an open Joker slot, I'll probably pick it up because it's going to be at worst net neutral, maybe net positive in terms of the money that I spent on it. If I don't have an open Joker slot, obviously I'm not going to make space for it, because ideally at that point I'd already have my econ engine going. But if you get it early enough, it can be useful. B tier for me, something that you move out of later, but that's what the card wants you to do anyway. Erosion gives you +4 Molt for every card less than your starting deck amount in your complete deck. So basically if you destroy cards, you get Molt from this. Destroying cards is something that I'm a big fan of doing and something that is achievable, but unless you get this early, you don't necessarily know that you need to do this, and you might have already added cards to your deck, so it can't be picked up in every run. If you can make it work, it can be very good. It can be a decent amount of Molt if you get 1-2 Immolates, if you're looking to pare down your deck with Trading Card or Hanged Man, but it definitely does not fit in every deck and has some downsides. It also has a bit of a ceiling compared to some of the other big flat Molt options that you have. Even Steven gives +4 Molt when an even card is scored. This is another one of those Jokers that's just kind of okay early, but starts to fall off as you get through the round. I'll only pick it up in a situation where I just desperately need a point scoring joker early in the run, but it does serve a purpose and can be useful, so it's a C tier joker for me. Faceless Joker gives you $5 if three or more face cards are discarded at the same time. Unfortunately, again, because of the reduced number of discards and hand sizes, this is not one that I found a good use for. It makes your plays a little bit clunky a lot of times. However, if it does get, if you do pull it off, it pays for itself essentially and is net positive. So you really only need to hit it once and you're good. But because of the hoops that you often have to jump through with a reduced hand size, it's very difficult to get that first hit and could leave you with a worse played hand as a result. So for me, this is not one that I'm terribly excited about. It certainly can have use cases, but it's a D tier joker for me. Fibonacci gives each played ace, 2, 3, 5, and 8 plus 8 molt when scored. You compare that to something like Even Steven, and it's literally double the molt if you shape your hand in a way that can support this. So because of that, it's a very good joker and even worth considering building around, especially if you have something that re-triggers the hands, something like a Dusk or some of the other cards that we'll talk about later. This can be very, very valuable. And simply a pair of aces gives you 16 molt, which is quite a bit of molt. For that reason, A tier joker, this is something that you could build your deck around if you get it early enough. Four Fingers allows all flushes and straights to be made with four cards. Unfortunately, there's not a whole lot of room for a utility joker. We've already talked about the fact that straights and flushes maybe aren't the best strategy for completing gold stake runs in a lot of situations, and you're sacrificing a joker slot in order to get a utility piece in there for that. So for that reason, I'm personally not super high on this. It does have its use cases because it can allow you to actually make those difficult to make hands. So this is a C tier joker for me, very situational depending on what build you're playing towards. Flashcard gives you plus 2 molt per reroll in the shop. This is one that I actually do like, but because it's so situational, it is difficult to get off. Very much like the Constellation, it can be very expensive to get off because you don't always have the Chaos the Clown in order to support this. This is once again a C tier joker. It has its uses if you have an abundance of money, but there aren't a lot of contexts where that's the case and you might be better off using that money working towards something else like tarot cards or card enhancements or even planet cards if you have that much money. Flower Pot gives you times 3 molt if played hand has a scoring card of each of the four suits. Times 3 molt is a lot of molt, so if you can reliably get this off, if you're building towards maybe a four of a kind or just have a lot of wild cards, this can be a very strong option. But that's not the case for every run, and a lot of the hands, again, my bias is towards easily attainable hands that aren't likely even going to have that many scoring cards, let alone that many scoring suits. So for me, this is a C tier. When it works, it's a big payoff. If you can reliably get it to hit, times 3 molt is incredible, but the lack of reliability drops it down a little bit for me. Fortune Teller gives you plus 1 molt per tarot card used in the run. Now this is great flat scaling for your flat molt option if you can get it early, but again, because of the expensive nature of the packs due to the higher stakes, this can be an expensive option and is probably dropped down a little bit in higher stake runs than it would be on lower stakes. Still, there are a lot of cards that generate tarot cards for you. Tarot cards are high value and you can still get this up nicely. It doesn't require you to have in hand when you're playing all of those tarot cards as well, so you can pick it up later and it'll still be a good option. B tier joker. Gift card adds $1 to the sell value of every joker and consumable card at the end of round. This is another okay econ joker if you have space in your joker roster and oftentimes can pay for itself. So if you have the space and you have the money, there may not be a good reason to pass on this, but late in the round, you're obviously not picking this up because you need to score points. So because it's so situationally dependent, it's probably a C tier joker for me. Glass Joker gives you times 0.5 molt for each glass card that is destroyed. This has potential to be very good, but there's awkward tension between the fact that you don't really want your glass cards to break because then you don't have them in your deck anymore, you've possibly invested in them, and the fact that this Joker does want those things to break, and you can't reliably get them to break. So it's a slow generating molt option that without a lot of glass cards is unlikely to get value. This is one that even if I have a handful of glass cards, I'm probably skipping. This is a D tier Joker for me. Gluttonous Joker gives you plus 4 molt when a club suited card is scored. I'm just gonna go ahead and group all of the suited Jokers together. That'll include Greedy, Lustful, and Wrathful Joker as well. I think these are all decent options early, but start to fall off quickly. Again, flushes don't scale well, and even in this case, plus 4 molt gives you a maximum of plus 20 molt, which is pretty good if you can reliably hit flushes of the same suit, but does start to fall off a little bit later compared to some of the other scaling options. So for that reason, I'm happy to pick these up early. They carry me through the early antes in a lot of situations, but I get out of them quickly. These are C-tier jokers for me. Golden Joker earns $4 at the end of each round. This is one that I've started taking a lot more frequently than I had in the past, and it almost always more than pays for itself and allows you to accumulate interest a little bit quicker. If I have space in my Joker roster, I'm picking this up. If I'm reliably hitting my score targets, I'm definitely picking this up. This is a really strong, good option. Kind of like we talked about with Cloud 9, probably belongs up in A tier alongside Cloud 9. Golden Ticket gives played gold cards $3 when scored. Now there's again weird tension here where gold cards typically want to be held in hand and they will still get you that $3. So you just end up giving up a Joker slot to get the same amount of money that you would otherwise get from your gold card by holding them in hand. This is not one that I've ever run. Doesn't seem valuable in nearly any instance. This is a D tier Joker for me. Green Joker gives plus 1 molt per hand played and minus 1 molt per discard. This is one that if I get early, it can carry a run. You can get some really good scaling out of this if you pick it up early enough. I'm excited to see it in one of the first few shops. Even in the first few antes, I might be inclined to pick this up. But it does really reshape the way that you're playing the game, so you can't pick it up later because of the decreased scaling, and you can't pick it up if you've already established a certain play style that doesn't allow you to just draw hand, play hand. So for that reason, it's a B tier Joker. When it's good, it's really good. When it appears late, you're just kind of minus one spot in the shop, unfortunately. Gross Michael gives you plus 15 molt with a 1 in 4 chance that this card is destroyed at the end of round. This is a very strong option for getting you through the early game with the understanding, like some of the other perishable items, that you're going to leverage that early strength to get your econ rolling over so that you can pick up jokers to replace it when it inevitably gone. Just think of it as a short-term rental to get you a little bit of money going, a little bit of strength so that you can survive, make that money, and see new shops where you pick up replacements for it. Because of that, B tier. Hack re-triggers each played 2, 3, 4, and 5. Now, this does require 2s, 3s, 4s, and 5s to be scored, so this doesn't fit into every deck. Obviously, it has nutty synergy with Fibonacci, but not every deck has Fibonacci. If you have the right context, Hack can pop off, but it doesn't fit in every circumstance. You can shape your deck around it if you find it early. Because it's uncommon, you don't always find it early, but it's a good Joker when it works well. Another B tier Joker for me. Half Joker gives you plus 20 molt if played hand contains 3 or fewer cards. This is a very, very strong option early that allows you to breeze through the early game and potentially shape your run around those easily attainable hands. Can start to fall off as you get late, so you might move out of it towards the later antes, but it can definitely help getting you there. Plus 20 molt is a lot of molt, especially if you have a multiplier for it. This is a B tier Joker for me and something that I'm really excited to pick up on early. It can really get a run taken off and allow me to get money rolling over. Hallucination gives you a 1 in 2 chance of creating a random tarot card when you open a pack. Unfortunately, again, once you get past Orange Stake, packs become really expensive over the course of the run, so if you don't get this early, it's not likely to be a viable option because you aren't likely to be wanting to buy packs. And again, utility jokers don't do as much in higher stake runs, so this is a D tier Joker for me. Hanging Chad re-triggers the first played card used in scoring. I think this one has some decent use cases in if you have specific cards, but most of the time it's just giving you another hit of chips that isn't really going to get you long-term benefit. And this is one that I'll pick up if I'm desperate or if I'm building around something like that, but not happy to see. This is C tier for me. Hiker permanently adds plus 4 chips to any card that is scored. This is another one that if you see early, it can help solve some of your chip issues going into the late game. Unfortunately, it doesn't give you much of an immediate benefit, so you really need to invest some time into this and then get out of it later once you've got your chips sorted out. But if you can find it early enough, it can really do a lot to ramp up your chip scaling and maybe reduce the burden of a chip joker going into the late game so that you can really get that molt going. as well as benefit from some of the retriggering options like Dusk, like Hack, that can really get those chip values up for some of your lower scoring cards. For that reason, this is a B tier option for me. Hit the Road gives you times 0.5 molt for every Jack discarded this round. This can be decent if you reliably hit Jacks or have an abundance of Jacks, or you have a nicely pared down deck. But if those are the cases and you're building around Jacks, often you want to be playing those Jacks, and this can create, again, some awkward tension there. This is not one that I'm happy to pick up as a multiplier unless I'm absolutely desperate. This is another D tier for me. Hologram gains times 0.25 molt per playing card added to your deck. This is another scaling multiplicative option that can, depending on where you are in the run, be easy to get online and be a good option going into the late game. There are also tools that allow you to amplify this without having to spend the money on packs. So if you get it early enough, it's a great, great option for having your score take off. This is a B tier joker for me. Ice Cream gives you plus 100 chips, but you lose 5 chips for every hand played. Very similar to Blue Joker, this is a really good option for breezing through the early game. It gives you a temporary solution to your chip scoring and is something that I'm just very happy to pick up if I have the space for it. Again, it's a temporary rental. It can often pay for itself by getting you out of the round faster with more remaining hands so that you get that money rolling over. Because of that, B tier Joker once again. Invisible Joker is a rare Joker where after 3 rounds, sell this Joker to duplicate a random Joker. Now, you might be tempted to compare this to something like Blueprint or Brainstorm, but you don't have nearly as much flexibility or reliability as you do for those two options. Additionally, carrying an Invisible Joker for 3 rounds in certain contexts, if you're not super strong compared to where the blinds are, can be a little bit difficult. It's also very expensive. When it's good, it's great, but there are just circumstances where you simply have to pass on this, even if you would love to double one of your Jokers, because you either can't afford it because it's too early in the run, which is when it's at its best, or you can't afford to play down a Joker for 3 straight rounds. Because of all of that, this is another B tier Joker for me. It can pop off and be nutty. Not always going to be the case though. Joker, baseline Joker gives you plus 4 molt. This is a D tier Joker, but I don't think it's the worst Joker in the game, especially early. If this is my first Joker, I'm just kind of okay with it. I have a reliable point scoring option to get me through the first ante. And I think an underappreciated aspect of this is very likely to end up being money positive if you have an empty Joker slot, simply because all it needs to do is get you out of one round, one hand faster, and it will pay for itself. So it's a D tier Joker with some decent upside. Joker Stencil gives you times 1 molt for each empty Joker slot. Now, playing down a Joker is a pretty big hindrance, but if you just have one open Joker slot, this is already giving you times 2 molt, which is a pretty decent amount of molt for the cost of obviously playing down a Joker is a bit of a hindrance in certain instances, so you're not going to take it in every context, but if you're desperate for some multiplicative scaling options, this could be it, and it's a solid B tier option. Jolly Joker gives you plus 8 molt if played hand contains a pair. This is very similar to Old Jimbo here, where this is something I pick up early. It probably pays for itself in the early game, but it's not a strong late game option and not something that I'm ever super excited to pick up. However, it can serve a purpose and can be a decent option. Juggler gives you plus 1 hand size. Now, similar to Drunkard, this is a decent utilities card that allows you to make more difficult to attain hands, but that's not generally what I have success with when playing on gold stake runs. So for that reason, on the higher stakes, the plus 1 hand size is nice. Having a utility Joker and not a point scoring Joker can be a bit of a hindrance. C tier. Loyalty card gives you times 4 molt for every 6 hands played. Unfortunately, this is often a very clunky solution to multiplicative scaling. Every 6 hands isn't even every round in most cases, and so it can leave you in awkward situations where when you need that multiplicative scaling the most, it's completely absent. And you compare this to something like Acrobat, where you can rely on it, you can shape your hand around that last played hand every time. I don't think this is a good solution to it. It's not one that I'm excited to pick up. If it's negative, great, I'll get a bonus every once in a while. Otherwise, I'm skipping this D tier. Luchador allows you to sell this card to disable the current boss blind. Unfortunately, this is another very situational Joker that I place in D tier. It can save you in certain instances where a very particular boss blind will create some problems, but you need to hold this until you get to that boss blind. And that means you're playing potentially the small and big blind of that same round with minus one joker slot. Then you're also playing that boss blind with minus one joker slot after you sell the luchador. So it's a combination of it being situational and having a pretty big downside once you get the benefit as well. So for that reason, again, D tier. Lucky Cat gains times 0.2 molt each time a lucky card successfully triggers. And that trigger has to happen while this is in your Joker roster. Because of that and the inherent unreliability of lucky cards, and the fact that I rate them lower than many of the other enhancements on tarot cards, this is a D tier option for me. It's too unreliable, it's too slow to build up, and not really something that you can guarantee will get you even the times two molt that you really want from your multiplicative scaling options at a minimum. Mad Joker gives you plus 20 molt if played hand contains a four of a kind. Again, not a reliable source of point scoring. So this is going to go in D tier with some of those other options like building straights and the chip scaling for building four of a kind. Not likely to trigger, not likely to be something that gets you a lot of reliable scoring early, and plus 20 molt doesn't even scale that well into the late game. So not really a good option or solution in nearly any context unless you're guaranteed hitting four of a kind and you don't have a better flat mold option. Another D tier Joker. Madness is the Joker that gains 0.5 times mold and destroys a random Joker when a blind is selected. Now, as much as I love this guy, he's pretty unreliable, but is in certain circumstances a very good option for multiplicative mold scaling. Obviously, he plays very nicely with Eternal Joker, so if your baseline strongest Joker is Eternal, this could be a good solution. But in a lot of cases, you are once again going to be playing down a Joker in order to give this guy times 0.5. If you find him early and can shape your run around him, he might be useful. I can't bring myself to put him in D tier, so it's a C tier Joker for me. Mail-in Rebate allows you to earn $3 for each discarded card of a random rank, which changes every round. There's another solid econ option, but can only fit in your roster if you have an open slot. And because of, again, the reduced hand size and the reduced number of discards, it can be awkward to pull off. So it's rated a little bit lower than it otherwise would be on higher stake runs. It's a B tier for me. Marble Joker adds one stone card to the deck when the blind is selected. Unfortunately, stone cards are often not the business that you want unless you're using this as an engine for Hologram or Vampire. It's not going to get a lot of value in most instances, and most runs don't include those two Jokers, so that's not a reliable strategy or reason to take Marble Joker. It certainly has its uses, but it's at baseline a D-tier Joker. Matador earns $8 if the played hand triggers the boss blind ability. This is an econ Joker that is very awkward to use. Again, like Luchador, it essentially requires that you play down a Joker for the boss blind, which could result in your death. And on top of that, it doesn't even guarantee that you get a benefit if you run into certain boss blinds. They might not trigger at all. They might not have the capacity to trigger at all. So unless you're strolling into a boss blind with an open Joker slot, and you know what the boss blind is, I see no reason to take this. This is often just a D-tier Joker for me that does have the potential to get value in very specific instances. Merry Andy gives you plus 3 discards, but minus 1 hand size. This is one that I probably underestimated early on in the run, but I'm still not a huge fan of, just because, yes, it allows you to see more of your deck and see more cards, but the additional discards sometimes can't necessarily make up for the reduced hand size in order to make specific hands and can get you into awkward situations. Again, utility Jokers also are something I rate a little bit lower on high stake runs just because of the very fast point scaling that happens as you get past purple stake. So for those reasons, C tier Joker. If you have space for it, you might be able to make good use of it, but I haven't found that to be often the case for me. Midas Mask reads all face cards become gold when played. Now, this is something that can be decent early enough because you often favor your face cards early and can get you a decent econ engine that will last you throughout the course of the run. Obviously, it has benefits when considering Vampire and Driver's License, but not every run includes those Jokers. So if you find it early, it's a solid option. Later in the run, you probably can't justify it. C tier Joker for me. Mime retriggers all card held in hand abilities. Now, this is something that's phenomenal for getting those giga-high scores with a bunch of steel cards in your hand, but you have to consider on Gold Stake especially, you have that reduced hand size and you have reduced discards, which means you aren't going to be necessarily holding all of those steel cards in your hand, and utility jokers are devalued here. This is another C-tier option for me with, again, some definite upside in the right circumstances, but most runs, I can't justify adding this to my joker roster. Misprint adds a random mult between 0 and 23. Now that is inclusive, so it can add 0, it can add 23. This is something early on when I was new to Balatro, I rated very highly because of the big hits were so big. And it does certainly help a lot with the early game, even on higher stake runs, but it falls off very quickly and is incredibly unreliable. So I've started rating this a lot lower. I get out of this once I get the opportunity and once I find better options for consistent flat mult. This is yet another C-tier joker for me. Mr. Bones prevents death if chips scored are at least 25% of the value to beat the blind. And then it does self-destruct after it saves you. Like Luchador, this is kind of a tech option that requires you to play down a joker and essentially requires you to die to get value off of it. But the problem with that is, in most cases, unless we're talking about maybe an extra large blind, if you can't beat the boss blind, you're not going to have much success on the next round once you have that increased scaling on the next ante. So unless you're banking on just hitting a really good shop, or again, you have no chance against a particular boss blind, this is not something that you want to pick up. This is a D-tier joker once more. Mystic Summit gives you plus 15 mult when 0 discards are remaining. This is pretty much at parity with Abstract. It might require you to play a little bit more awkwardly than Abstract would with a full joker roster, and it does potentially fall off as you get into the later rounds, but it's a solid pickup that can carry your early game, and for that reason, like Abstract, it's an A-tier joker. Obelisk gives you times 0.2 mult per consecutive hand played without playing your most played poker hand. Now this is one that when it pops off, it's incredible. It can give you a lot of multiplicative scaling. It requires effort though and foresight. So if you pick it up early and you have the capacity to carry it, your run could be solved at that point as long as you get some decent flat mult. However, if you pick it up late and you've already built around a very specific hand type, it's just not something that can be included in your deck, and it becomes a bit too fragile option that you can't necessarily guarantee will get you a whole lot of value. So it's another one of those jokers where when it's good, it's very good, but there are a lot of situations where you just simply cannot take this joker, so it's a B-tier option for me. Odd Todd gives plague cards with odd rank plus 30 chips when scored. Now this is similar to Even Steven, but chips are frequently a little bit harder to come by than your flat mult. So this is something I rate a little bit higher than Even Steven and may stick around a little bit longer. You also consider the fact that aces are commonly played cards and commonly scored cards that get benefit from Odd Todd. So because of that, it's a B-tier joker in my book. Onyx Agate gives played cards with club suit plus 8 mult when scored. If you compare this to something like Fibonacci and Even Steven, it's obviously closer to the Fibonacci, but maybe a little bit less reliable unless you're specifically building around clubs or have shaped your deck in such a way that you can get benefit from it, like you might with shaping your deck around Fibonacci, but it's something that I've had a little bit less success with consistently hitting like I do Fibonacci, and for that reason, it's slightly lower in B tier for me, can still be, contextually at least, a very good option for getting you flat mult, especially if you again have those re-trigger abilities. Oops All Sixes doubles all probabilities. Now this is again a utility piece that you maybe would want to justify in certain instances, but it doesn't itself score you points, so I can't justify taking this in nearly any situation. This is a D-tier joker for me. Similarly, Pareidolia reads all cards are considered face cards. This is a very niche support piece that I have been able to make use of, especially if you get bonus point scoring from your face cards from some of the other jokers that we have available, but even then starts to fall off and really wants to be replaced by something that is scoring you points. This is another D-tier option. Perkeo creates a negative copy of one random consumable card in your possession at the end of shop. Now, this may seem like a contradiction in that it looks like a utility piece, but because of the ability to generate multiple copies of certain high-value tarot cards or even planet cards, this can actually just be a solid point scoring option that scales you going into the late game. It can pare down your deck if that is your goal. I think this is something that nearly any deck would love to see and allows it to be more consistent in either its hand making or its point scoring. So for that reason, this is probably another S tier joker for me. This is a very strong option that you can get a lot of value on, even if you don't ride it out throughout the course of the run. Photograph gives the first played face card x2 molt when scored. It's gonna be great if you're running a lot of molt cards with your face cards, which face cards tend to be priority targets for your molt cards. If you have other jokers that benefit or give bonuses to your face cards, this can be great for it. But that's not every build, it's situational, and for that reason, it falls into C tier for me. When it's good, it can be useful and can score you a lot of points, but that's not every instance. Personally, I find it, especially early, a little bit less useful than some of the other point scoring options. Popcorn gives +20 molt, but -4 molt for each round played. This is another one of those options where you're just kind of taking a rental on it, and it can frequently pay for itself by getting you out of rounds with fewer hands played so that you generate more money off of it. It can allow you to breeze through the early antes essentially by itself and set you up to find those longer term jokers that you need to win a run. This is a B tier option for me. I'm not picking it up late in most instances, but I'm ecstatic to see it early. Raised Fist gives double the rank of the lowest card held in hand to molt. This is another one that I'm really happy to see early, and even in some instances, depending on what types of hands I'm playing, I might be happy to find it in the late game. Like Blackboard, you can shape the hand that you're playing around something like Raised Fist, but it does have the capacity to fall off and is maybe a little bit less reliable than something that just has a flat multiplier printed on the card. And so for that reason, it's another B tier joker for me. Ramen gives x2 molt, but loses 0.01 molt per card discarded. Multiplicative molt options are always very high priority picks for me, and Ramen is just baseline pretty good. Even if you discard a number of times, or if you need to discard, as long as you're keeping it above like the 1.75 range, it's probably better than most of the other options that you've seen at that point. So for that reason, it's an A tier joker and it's just a high priority pick for me. Red Card is a scaling joker that gains +3 molt when any booster pack is skipped. Unfortunately, again, with the orange stake price scaling, this is essentially a no-go once you get beyond that point and for gold stake runs. I have won runs with Red Card. It is very difficult to do, though, because you have to invest so much money, essentially $10 or $11 in later rounds just for +3 molt. That's not very good. Obviously, the earlier you get it, the better, but then you're spending money to not get anything other than +3 molt. Not really a good trade-off in most cases. Reserved Parking gives each face card held in hand a 1 in 2 chance to give $1. This is kind of the opposite of the business card joker. Depending on the context, if you're building towards holding face cards, like the Raised Fist, as opposed to playing face cards, like with the photograph, it's similar to business card in that it's the opposite, but it's just as reliable and gives you half as much money, so probably a worse option, depending on what your build is, but still could be a decent econ joker where if you have space for it, it could pay for itself. Again, contextually dependent, this is a B tier option, probably low B tier compared to business card. Ride the Bus gives +1 molt for every hand played without scoring a face card. Resets to +0 when a face card is scored. So this does change and shape the way that you're playing, but if you pick it up early enough, that might not matter, and early is when you want to pick this up because you want to scale it up early. If I see this early, I'm snagging it in nearly any context, no matter what deck I'm playing. Obviously, it's the Turbo Nuts on the Abandoned deck, but it's good in every other deck as well. This is an A tier joker for me, one of the best flat scaling molt options available to you. Riffraff generates 2 common jokers when a blind is selected if you have room. This is one where if it's early, I am very happy to see this. It could generate decent point scoring jokers while also simultaneously getting me econ because I can sell out of anything that I don't want to keep while trying to get more hits. I don't have to spend money on jokers so I can get to the interest cap and really be very particular with the jokers that I choose instead of spending money to just get okay things. But late in the run, this is just a dead option. You don't want no part of it. It's too unreliable. So for that reason, it's a C tier option. Good early, bad late. It's very similar to Rocket, which gives $1 at the end of round, earning increases by $2 when boss blind is defeated. This is close to, but not as good as maybe a gold joker because it takes time to get online. You want to get out of your econ jokers a little bit faster on gold stake runs, but it can generate a decent amount of value, especially if you get it right before a boss blind and you have an open joker slot. It's going to start scaling up quickly and getting you a lot of money. So early good, later it starts to fall off like a lot of the econ jokers, honestly. So it's another C tier option for me. Showman allows Joker, Tarot, Planet, and Spectral cards to appear multiple times. Unfortunately, this is another utility Joker that doesn't guarantee a benefit. Just because you have this Joker doesn't mean you'll see the duplicate of the thing that you want, and you might be carrying it for absolutely no reason. This is a D tier option for me. Rough Gem gives played cards with Diamond Suit $1 when scored. This is something that I rated low early on once again, and then I actually started picking it up, and it's okay. It's pretty decent. It's a good econ engine. It does require that you play diamonds and score diamonds, which may not be a super reliable way, but it can quickly pay for itself. So if you get it early enough, you might be able to make good use out of this. Like other econ jokers, you're not inclined to pick it up late though. So C tier option, like many of the other econ jokers. Runner gains plus 10 chips if played hand contains a straight. Again, we've talked about how difficult straights are to make. Chip generating jokers are wonderful and useful and something that you need to get, especially early on. But making straights is a little bit too difficult on gold stake runs, and it scales a little bit too slowly for my taste. This is another D tier option. Speaking of straights, Seance requires you to play a straight flush, and if you do, it'll generate a random spectral card. Unfortunately, this is one of the rare jokers that I'm the least excited to see. It does the least for me. Even if I bend over backwards and make that straight flush, there's no guarantee that the spectral card is going to do anything useful for me. So it's just an expensive joker taking up a slot that has no guaranteed payoff and requires you to do silly things. D tier. Satellite gains $1 at the end of round for every unique planet card used this run. This is maybe one of the worst econ jokers on par with the golden ticket. It can obviously generate a lot of money, but again, econ is something that you want early in a run. And early in a run, you probably haven't opened a lot of celestial packs because you're looking to find jokers and establish your point scoring that way. So this is not likely to get a good return on your investment compared to some of the other ones. D tier. Scary Face gives played face cards plus 30 chips when scored. Chips are, even with face cards, pretty highly valued. You want one solid chip generator, and this could be it if you're playing a lot of face cards. It has some benefits if you're re-triggering options as well. So this is a pretty solid choice if you're building around face cards and is a B-tier joker. Scholar gives played aces plus 20 chips and plus 4 molt when scored. Aces are something that almost always when you play them, they are scoring, so you're going to get a lot of value off of this. This is simultaneously a chip scoring joker and a flat molt joker while taking up one joker slot. So you get a lot of value off of this while also benefiting again from re-trigger options. This is just a solid A tier joker. Aces are something that are frequently worth building around, and this is a good joker to go with it. Scene Double gives you times 2 molt if played hand has a scoring club and a scoring card of any other suits. This is kind of similar in its requirements to Flower Pot, a little bit more easily attainable, but still a little bit less consistent than I'd like it to be, 4x2 molt. So I think it's right around the Flower Pot rating in C tier for me. It can be a solution for multiplicative scaling, which is important, but it's not a super reliable one that I rate very highly. So I think C tier is a good place for it. Seltzer re-triggers all played cards for the next 10 hands. This is a really good re-triggering option, but does require you to get some benefit out of re-triggering it. If you're just getting chips out of it, if you don't have something like a Scholar or Fibonacci or even a Scary Face like we talked about, you're not going to be able to make good use of this, but it's something that can be phenomenal in the early game for just scoring new points. And if you do have something set up like a Scholar or a Fibonacci, it can be worth considering adding to your joker roster for the last ante as well, just because it can work as a basically a blueprint for some of those re-triggering options if you've built around them. So it can be good late. It's also very consistently good early, like many of the other perishable items. Shoot the Moon gives you plus 13 molt for each queen in hand. This can be a decent option if you're early in a run and just desperately need flat molt. I'm almost never picking this up, no matter how many queens I have late in the run, just because, again, that small hand size, and the fact that if you have a lot of queens, you're probably going to be wanting to play them. So this is a C-tier joker for me. It can get you out of the early game and towards better jokers, but you really want to move out of it once you find those better options. Shortcut allows straights to be made with gaps of one rank, and there can be multiple gaps in a straight. We've talked a little bit about how straights are undervalued, especially with the reduced hand size. If you are playing straights, it's probably because you picked up a shortcut and this is a decent enabler, on par and maybe even better at enabling hands than the four fingers. I don't think you want to be running both of these in most cases, but this can allow you to actually make and build around straights, which is not something that's done naturally on gold stake runs. Sixth Sense reads, if the first played hand of the round is a single six, destroy it and create a spectral card. Now, like Seance, not a huge fan of this one. It's another D tier option for me. It requires you to draw your sixes early and not necessarily get much benefit out of them because a single spectral card can be very inconsistent. So this is another D tier. Sly Joker gives plus 50 chips if played hand contains a pair. This is another one of those jokers where not great going into the late game, but can help you in a bind early if you're desperate for a chip generator. Playing pairs is something that's easily attainable, so unlike the three of a kind and four of a kind options, is something that I'm just okay with picking up early, which is when it's at its best, but I definitely don't want it late in the run. I want to have a better solution for finding chips than this. Smeared Joker allows hearts and diamonds to count as the same suit, as well as spades and clubs to count as the same suit. This is, again, on par with probably four fingers for enabling flushes, and can be a decent option while maybe you're getting some deck shaping ready to go, or just making flushes a little bit easier as you start scaling them up for the late game. So another C tier option. Again, utility pieces are a little bit undervalued in gold stake runs because of the high scaling blinds. Smiley Face gives played face cards plus 4 molt when scored. Again, you can make the comparison to Even Steven and Fibonacci, where you're getting half as much molt per card scored, but these cards are scoring a little bit more reliably. Because it's outclassed by a lot of other flat mold options, I think it's just kind of down in C tier with Even Steven. It's probably close to as easy to get them to score, and doesn't really have the same late game potential as something like a Fibonacci. Sock and Buskin re-triggers all face cards an additional time. This is one where if you're building around face cards and you have space, it can be a decent option. It can help with your business card hits early. It can help with your point scoring jokers as well. But if you're not really building around those, it doesn't fit into your deck. So because it's very situationally dependent, I think it's a C tier joker as well. It does obviously have the potential to go big, but that's not every run. That's not every instance. Space Joker has a 1-in-4 chance to upgrade the level of played poker hand before it's scored. As much as I love this guy, the lack of reliability and the diminishing returns that you get from leveling up poker hands compared to, again, the fast scaling on higher stakes, as much as I love this guy, I can't justify putting him above C tier. He's honestly probably on the low end of C tier just because of the inherent inconsistent nature of him. Spare Trousers gains plus 2 molt when a scoring hand contains a 2 pair. I mean, anybody who's watched my channel knows this is going at least to A tier. This is one of the stronger scaling flat molt options because it generates that flat molt twice as fast as many of the other ones with a relatively attainable hand that you don't have to necessarily commit to. You can play some two pairs early, get this level up, and then ride it out into the late game for a decent flat molt option. Splash allows every played card to count in scoring. Now, this is something that I probably rate a little bit higher than many people just because I play a lot of those easily attainable hands, things like pairs and high card, where the limiting factor is often the amount of chips that you're scoring. And so this can provide a chip solution for those types of hands, but that's not every run. Where it really is beneficial is untriggered joker effects like Fibonacci, Even Steven that we've talked about, and that's, once again, not every run. So as much as I do like this card in certain contexts, it probably can't justify putting it over C tier. Steel Joker gives times 0.25 molt for each steel card in your full deck. Steel cards are highly, highly valuable, and for that reason, you're going to be adding a lot of them to your deck. And for that reason, this is an A tier joker that you're just often excited to see. Steel Jokers already give multiplicative scaling, and then you get this on top of that. Once again, kind of like Ramen, you're really looking for it to be at least at that 1.75 to above 2 value. But if it's doing that, it's an immediate pick, and then you just start searching for more steel cards if you can, or generating them in some way. Square Joker gains plus 4 chips if played hand contains exactly 4 cards. Once again, like the spare trousers. Anybody that's watched my videos probably knows that this is going way up here. This is one of my favorite chip scaling jokers, especially if you get it early. I even find myself picking it up later into runs just so that I can get that chip bonus and get my hand scoring a lot more points, especially critical if you're playing those easily attainable hands. If you're playing something like a square joker and either a ride the bus or a spare trousers, it almost doesn't matter what the hand that you're playing is because your jokers will score so many points for you. For that reason, immediate A tier. In certain situations, you can't pick it up, especially if it's late in the run, but early on it can carry you. Stone Joker gives plus 25 chips for each stone card in your full deck. Unfortunately, this is chip generation, but not a lot, and it requires you to dilute your deck with stone cards. I'm probably a bigger fan of stone cards than many people because of the way that I play, and even then, this is just not a strong option, in my opinion, for generating chips, and is probably well-placed in D tier. Stuntman, on the other hand, gives you plus 300 chips and minus 2 hand size. Plus 300 chips is an obscene amount of chips. Obviously, there's a huge downside to the negative 2 hand size, but if you have a decent flat molt joker as well as some multiplicative scaling, again, it doesn't matter what the hand is that you're playing if you're generating this many points just from your jokers. I think, obviously, you do not want Stuntman if you're building towards difficult to attain hands, things like 4-of-a-kind, 5-of-a-kind, even 3-of-a-kind, that's not a good option. But if you're building pairs and high card, this is your joker. This is your chip generator. So I think this is an A tier joker for me. It's something that I vastly, vastly underestimated until I started picking it up. Supernova adds the number of times poker hand has been played to molt. This is another A tier joker for me. Obviously, this is related to my playstyle of playing and focusing on easily attainable hands. But the real benefit to Supernova is, unlike some of the other flat scaling options for your molt, it doesn't matter necessarily when in the run you pick this up. If you've played a bunch of high card, if you've played a bunch of pair, two pair early, and you see it in a shop late, it's just already ready to go for you. The same is true even if you're a flush deck. It doesn't matter when in the shop this appears. It can give you an immediate boost to your flat molt and can be a very good option. So once again, A tier for me. Superposition creates a tarot card if played hand contains an ace and a straight if you have room. This is very similar to Seance, where it's a very difficult to achieve requirement, and then on top of that, the payoff is not very consistent. There are better ways to get tarot cards into your deck, so this is another D tier joker for me. Swashbuckler adds the sell value of all owned jokers to the left of this card to molt. This is something that I was pretty high on when I first started playing Balatro, and as I started playing on higher difficulties, it really, really becomes apparent just how much this joker falls off. Obviously, there are cute synergies with things like gift card and egg, but that's not every run. It also has awkward tension with your multiplicative jokers, which want to go on the right-hand side of your joker roster, but so does the swashbuckler. Those are also often your most expensive jokers, so it's not getting the full benefit of the joker cost, and honestly barely gets above 10 in a lot of instances, especially early, which is when he's at his best. And so for that reason, it's a C tier joker. It can be okay. It can be a good temporary measure, but long term, it needs to go as soon as you find a better option. The duo gives times 2 molt when hand contains a pair. I think despite it being the lowest multiplier, this is maybe the best option for the rare multiplicative jokers. And for that reason is an A tier option for me. Just again, that's partially my playstyle and partially the fact that it fits into an abundance of different decks, right? Whether you're playing 3-of-a-kind, 4-of-a-kind, 5-of-a-kind, the duo fits there and just is a decent option for giving you times 2 molts. So because of that, it's an A tier joker for me. You pick it up almost in any circumstance, unless you're playing a deck that just never makes pairs. The family gives times 4 molt when hand contains 4-of-a-kind. This is situationally potentially your best joker and something that you would copy with a blueprint or maybe even a brainstorm if the situation calls for it. But I rate it on par, but a little bit lower than duo just because of the lack of flexibility. The fact that it really, really requires you to pare down your deck and ensure that you're hitting 4-of-a-kind every hand. Otherwise, you're not getting the benefit as consistently as you would with the duo. The idol gives times 2 molt when a random specific card is scored, and that card changes every round. Again, I just compared the reliability of the family and the duo, and the idol is much, much less consistent than both of those. And for that reason, reason I find it pretty hard to justify taking and is a D tier joker for me. The order gives times 3 mult if played hand contains a straight. This one, I'm probably going to rate a little bit lower than its inherent value is simply because of the difficulty in making straights. That said, if you're playing a straight build, this is probably the reason why. Times 3 mult is a lot of mult. It can really take off when you are playing straights and get you a lot of point generation, but because they're a little bit less consistent, I drop this one down to B tier. Not a fan of making straights when it comes to gold stake runs. I'm also personally not a big fan of making flushes, which the tribe gives times 2 mult when the hand contains a flush. That said, flushes are still marginally easier to make in a lot of situations. You also have more suit fixing options than you do order fixing options. So flushes are for that reason a little bit more consistent and have a little bit more upside than straights as well. This is an A tier joker. Again, if you're playing flushes, it's probably with this card in mind and wanting to add this card to your joker roster. The trio gives times 3 mult when the hand contains 3 of a kind. I think this is, again, on par, maybe in between the family and duo. It's a little bit more flexible. 3 of a kind hits more hands than 4 of a kind does, obviously, so you can get better use out of it. Times 3 mult is still a lot of mult and is still a very good option if you can consistently make the hand requirements. So it's another A tier option and probably pretty high on the A tier list as well. Throwback gives 0.25 mult for each blind skip this run. I've talked a little bit about this previously, but I'm not a big fan of skipping frequently, which this requires you to do. It means that you're not scaling up certain jokers. It means that you're not seeing as many shops to potentially get stronger there, and can be a bit limiting if you don't have really good tag options available to you. That said, if there's ever an incentive to skip, it could be throwback. It also doesn't matter necessarily when you skip, so you don't have to have this joker in your roster when you're skipping. Still could be a decent multiplicative option and is a B tier joker for me. When it's good, it can be very good, but you know, I'd probably rate it a little bit lower than hologram even, just because I can more reliably get hologram going than I can a throwback in most runs. To-do list earns $5 if poker hand is a specific poker hand, and that poker hand changes after every payout. So this is a little bit inconsistent, but if you just hit the baseline poker hand, it probably pays for itself after you sell it. So it's another one of those decent econ jokers that is at worst money neutral, because you're probably just skipping this if it says straight flush or four of a kind and you don't have the capacity to make those hands. But if it's something easily attainable that doesn't make you throw a round in order to get there, I think it can be good. And it's just an okay econ option and a B tier joker for me. On the other hand, To the Moon earns an extra $1 of interest every $5 you have at the end of round. We talked about this with the bull and bootstraps. Really milking interest on higher stakes runs is not something that you often have the capacity to do unless you're already very strong, and you frequently want to leverage that money into strength so that you can keep up with the blind scaling. This is not one that I am very happy to pick up and is a D tier joker for me. Trading card reads, if first discard of the round only has one card, destroy it and earn $3. There's another very good econ option that simultaneously gives you some deck fixing, with the caveat that, again, you have fewer discards on higher stake runs. It can be difficult to make the hands that you're building towards if you use half of your discards on a trading card. But because it's still very valuable and still has the ability to shape your deck for the future, this is a good early pickup and falls into B tier for me, with some serious upside if you get it very early. Tribule is another legendary joker that reads, played kings and queens each give times 2 mult when scored. So this is another option where if you have the Sock and Buskin, it can really take off because that times 2 mult is happening when they're triggering. If you have high density of mult cards or red seals, this is very good. So it can really, really allow your face card build to start taking off and scoring a bunch of points. If you have that type of build, this is a great addition to it and is an A tier option. Unfortunately, it's unreliable, not to get value off of, but to actually acquire. And so it is an A tier joker, but I don't think you should build a run expecting to get it. If you get it, you can shape your run around it. Troubadour gives +2 hand size, but -1 hands per round. Now, this is another one of those utility jokers that I rate about on par with the other 2. Again, I'm not a huge fan of carrying them. I'm probably less of a fan of this one in particular than most people, just because I like getting my extra hands to scale up my green jokers, ride the bus, and spare trousers. So with my playstyle in particular, I'm not a huge fan of this joker, but it certainly can fit into certain builds, but is another C tier option as a somewhat unreliable utility piece for me. Turtle Bean gives +5 hand size, but reduces at the end of each round. This is another consumable option and is probably on par with Seltzer in its ability to be very strong early to make sure that you make big hands to get through rounds quickly, as well as very strong late to make sure you get big hands to keep up with the increased blind scaling. So if you're playing towards a less attainable hand than something like a pair or high card, this could be a good support piece to make those hands more attainable and get through some higher scaled boss blinds in one or two hands a little bit easier. Vagabond creates a tarot card if you play a hand with $3 or less. Honestly, if you get this early, it can be a run-defining piece and can not only scale up your fortune teller, which you don't always hit just because you have a Vagabond, but can really increase the overall value of your deck. But it does have the cost of requiring you to be poor for all of the rounds while you're getting value off of this. So it doesn't necessarily fit in every context, but if you have space for it early, which is when you're at your most broke, it can be a good piece to really establish the early game and set you up for a strong late game. For that reason, it's an A tier joker for me. I love this guy. Vampire gains times 0.2 molt per enhanced card played, but it removes the enhancement. For me, this is one of my favorite multiplicative scaling options. It can get out of control really fast. You can very easily shape your run to feed the vampire, which will almost solo carry if you even just have a decent enough flat multiplier. For that reason, unless it's almost at the end of a run, I see a vampire, I take a vampire. This is an S tier joker for me. Walkie Talkie reads each played 10 or 4 gives +10 chips and +4 molt. So this is kind of similar to Scholar, except more specific to cards that you're less inclined to have a high density of or less inclined to score as frequently, but is still a very strong early game option. I rate this as a B tier. It's something that when it's my first joker, I'm pretty happy to see it, and I know that I can be pretty confident in getting out of the early game with a decent amount of money. Wee Joker is a rare joker that gains +8 chips when each 2 is scored. This is maybe the best and the fastest chip scaling joker that you can get, and like Square Joker, can really take off if you get it early. So I think I rate it about on par with both Stuntman and Square Joker as a long-term chip option. The downside of it is that it can be difficult to actually score 2s because you either need to make a pair or better with them, or you need to throw hands away to just play high card 2, which leaves you at risk of losing the run or costs you $1 each time you do. So it's a little bit less reliable to scale up per hand than a Square Joker, but has a little bit better upside long term as a result of the increased scaling that it has. Wily Joker gives +100 chips if played hand contains a 3 of a kind. Like some of the other early chip generating options for less attainable hands, this is not necessarily a great option. Even though it gets more chips than the pair version, it's less consistent. So for that reason, especially in the early game when you don't have the deck shaping in order to make that 3 of a kind consistently, and when you have -1 hand size, I'm not a big fan of this. I often skip this even if I am maybe considering building towards a 3 of a kind or better hand later. So for that reason, D tier again for me with the others. Yorick is another legendary joker that gives x5 molt, which is impressive, but only after using 23 discards. And you have to have him active and in your joker roster while you discard those 23 times. That's unfortunate for a couple of reasons on Gold Stake. Again, you have fewer discards, so 2 discards per round means even if you're maxing out those discards, you're going to have a long time before Yorick is online. And you're carrying a rather expensive joker that isn't necessarily doing anything before he gets online. So unless you're already reasonably strong and in the early game, this is not a great joker. But if you're able to get it early and you're able to take the time to discard through it, maybe getting additional discards through vouchers or jokers. It can certainly pop off into the late game, but that's not a reliable strategy when you're just trying to survive the early game on gold stake. Our final joker is Zany Joker, which gives plus 12 molt if played hand contains a three of a kind. It's going to be very similar and just fall into the same category of D tier as some of the other options for those less attainable hands. On top of that, plus 12 molt is just worse than a Mystic Summit. It's just worse than a fully online abstract joker and has a much more stringent requirement than both of those cards. So this is one that I'll take it if I'm absolutely desperate and can consistently make three of a kind or full houses, but isn't something that I'm super excited about and will look to definitely replace as soon as possible because there are much better options that are much more reliable for getting plus 12 molt. All right, that's it. That is all 150 jokers rated based on my experience with them in gold stake. Let me know down in the comments if you agree, disagree, what you think. And if you're interested in seeing me play some gold stake runs, make sure to head over to twitch.tv/roffle. Give me a follow and you can watch the runs in real time as I'm trying to apply some of the strategies that I talked about here. With that, thanks for watching and I'll see you in tomorrow's video.